LS election fever winds down and the COMELEC proclaims winners in the midterm polls, the country is slowly returning to business as usual. But for politicians with lofty ambitions, the true race will come 3 years from now. And to give us their outlook for how the 2016 presidential race could shape up and how the results in this year's midterm polls could affect the decisions of possible contenders, we're joined here in the studio by Dean Tony Lavinia of the Ateneo School of Government, Professor Jun Salipsip of the Institute of Strategic and National Studies, and Malou Tiquia, founder and general manager of Publicus Asia. Thank you very much, lady and gentlemen, for joining me this afternoon. So, were the results, can I just start out, were the results at least near what you may have expected to come out? Ladies first.
Yes, I do believe that the results show to everyone that CPAG, scientific way of running, message, discipline to stick to message, would bear fruit. So kung ano yung ginawa nila before is reflective in the most important survey of any race, which is the election day.
Right. Professor Jun?
I think the result of the election today is a reflection of our voters. Our voters, for example, Grace Poe, the mother is a celebrity. The father was also a celebrity. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a reflection of our voters' mentality also. You'll also notice that the number two is a from broadcast media before. And so I think it's the influence of broadcast media and celebrity. It's also other groups of people that got elected, like Trillanes and Honasan. It's the military. Mm-hmm. And of course, the dynasty. So these are the three elements now that you can see in the election returns.
All right, Dean Tony?
Yeah, my answer to your question first is that yes, I expect the results, except the ranking, particularly Poe being first and also Sunny Angara.
You didn't expect Grace Poe to be first?
No, I expected her fourth or fifth. Sunny Angara was expected 10th, 11th, 12th, right? Mm-hmm. And I think my takeaway from that is family and celebrity matters, but it's not enough. They have to have a good campaign and a good candidate to offer, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's also the story of the final 12 when we finally get them.
Yeah. I think I want to take off also from what Malou said. You said it's a scientific way of running the campaign. You have to stay on message. Well, let me pick an example of somebody who always stayed on message, Risa Ontiveros. I mean, she was very specific about what she stood for, but it didn't seem to matter to the voters.
Tony, the problem with that campaign is that they've used that messaging in 2010. That means you have to offer something more than what you have offered in 2010.
You have to rebrand yourself?
Not necessarily. The problem with the 2010 branding of Risa Ontiveros was really departing from her core, which is Palaban, a person who stands for cause. When you say magandang laban, that somehow softens, and I think that was the initial suggestion before, that you have to soften up the image of Risa, and I don't agree with that, because when people started seeing her doing the flick with her alampay, then people were saying, ito yung Risa dati, that the person we missed. Mm-hmm. So, and it came out too late.
Okay. So it should have really begun before the campaign pala.
Yes, because the 2013 is not the continuation of your campaign in 2010. Mm-hmm. That is a wrong paradigm.
Mm-hmm. But you know, talking about message and talking about branding, I guess for us, and we've seen how she dramatically went up in the surveys, and now in the election rankings, she's pretty much within the safe top five. Nancy Binay, I mean, everybody expected that she'd be the target of black propaganda, and still manage to withstand all of that and come up with this kind of performance.
Yeah, no, that's clearly a good example also of a good and disciplined campaign. She never took the bait. In all the attacks against her, she took on the underdog role.
Except for Vice Ganda's remarks.
That was really minor. I mean, and I think I actually think all the attacks against her backfired. And intentionally or not, I think it might have even affected Risa's vote, you know, because it was sort of, they were always trying to compare. Some supporters were always
sinong mas karapat dapat
to compare, right? And you know how Filipinos like, they like the underdog. And so I think that backfired. I mean, when people see that something unfair is being done, and you know, something that's not right is being done to someone, and they do react and they sympathize. Mm.
Now I want to go to Professor Jun's observation. You either be a celebrity, show business, or maybe in the military. But Greg Onasan, I mean, he's way down there. And it doesn't seem to help him anymore. What happened to Greg Onasan? I mean, compared to Sonny Trillanes, Sonny Trillanes is still pretty much performing well.
I think it's based also on performance, because I think Trillanes hugged the limelight before when he was trying to take some issues, especially with Enrile. Mm-hmm.
So I going head to head with Enrile.
Exactly. So it shows that he's a strong man, and I think as a result of that, it boosted his standing. Mm-hmm. But the other thing, when it comes to Binay, I think the point that we must take here is that, in spite of the fact that she probably did not work in any government capacity, when Vice President Binay was campaigning or is going around the country, he used this organization, and he always brings the daughter with him. And so as a result of that, he's already practically campaigning at that time.
Sure.
And I think as a result of his her sorties with her father, her stock really went up. Mm-hmm. So it was the organization and the campaign that happened before that boosted her stock.
You know, I didn't notice, maybe it just slipped my attention, but did Jack Enrile appear in his commercials with Vice President Jeje Marbina?
No. Think the only candidate that the Vice President appeared on a TV ad would be Meg Subiri and the daughter. Mm-hmm. I think the endorsement value of the three kings were purely focused on their sons and daughter. Mm-hmm. The reason why Vice President Binay appeared with Meg Subiri was, again, early on, he was the one instrumental in bringing, and that resulted to, you know, Coco Pimentel leaving Una.
Right. And the surprising thing is the value of that endorsement, as you say, it doesn't seem to reflect on the standings now in the senatorial race. I mean, where is Meg Subiri? And in fact, where is JV Ejercito in the standings now? I mean, the three kings, have they lost their luster in the endorsement power?
Well, you know, clearly the president has you know, stronger endorsement power. But I think, as Malou pointed out, because it was a very diffuse endorsement rather than a focused one. I mean, and I think that's why the endorsements failed.
Yeah. Well, does it surprise you that somebody who would be associated with former President Joseph Estrada isn't performing as well as the other candidates in UNA?
I think by comparison, the ideology of the president, I think, is much stronger than the ideology of the other party. So I think the ideology of the president carried a lot of weight, and as a result of that, carried the other candidates with him. Mm. So that's why it's a big portion of the...
But if you're talking about ideology, Professor Jun Malou and Dean Tony, ano, bakit hindi nadala na 12-0 sweep? I mean, all of them identified with the president campaigned for all of them, actually appeared in their ads. Why wouldn't it translate to a 12-0 sweep?
Because you go back again to the fact that the choices were, there is no opposition slate really. It's coming from the same banana, as people would say. And they merely probably contrasted themselves enough to say at the start that, hey, we're different. We're with Binay. And the other party, which is really an aggregation of several odd political parties who were at each other's neck in 2010, it's so hard to put them together and have that team spirit. And you noticed that at the start. But I think the president held on to the belief that, you know, we're Team Pinoy, I will lend my political capital to you, you stay with me. That's why, if you notice in the sorties, it's always the president who's always 100% present. Mm-hmm. And those who are capable of launching their own campaigns were doing their own thing. Mm-hmm. So kung sino yung masipag, always with the president, you get that, you can hang on that coattail. Mm-hmm. Because this president has a coattail. I mean, it's only 3 years, and he has that coattail. He has proven that with this midterm election. Compared to the mother, who had to, you know, go to the process of martial law. Tapos, you have new faces like Sagisag, yeah. Paterno, Shahani. Yeah. You know, they, those people will never made it as senators. But because of the former president, Cory Aquino, being popular and having the coattails, that's the same effect. But this one is, after 3 years, may coattail ka na. It's, yeah. it's something... That people would probably have to study.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you really never had a midterm president that campaigned like this
yes.
president did. I mean, it was actually a very disciplined president, Aquino, that
But Gloria Arroyo campaigned pretty hard too.
For her candidates, I don't think so. Not compared to this one.
Probably
I mean,
not going to the the barnstorming is something that
every,
she doesn't like.
Every big sortie, the president was there, and he had ads for everyone. I don't remember mm-hmm. President. Maybe she didn't have a coattail as well, and maybe candidates also running away yeah. from her. But you know, we did actually a series of fact checks on the elections, and one of the things that we found out was that. When you just map out the issues, you know, you go crazy because the UNA and the Team Pinoy candidates are crisscrossing each other on the issues. They're not together in issues. They're just very different on different issues.
Mm. Well, when we say that this is a referendum on the president's Tuwid na Daan program and how it actually maps the road to 2016, when people look at the rankings of senators, I mean, they always say, ayung number one, number two, sigurado, papatakbo ng presidente yan dahil hawak na nila eh. Meron na silang parang bailiwick, to, so to speak. Eh. Because we saw in her advertisements, Susan Rosa saying na, anak, ikaw na magpapatuloy ng pangarap, di ba? Ibig sabihin nung pangarap nung hindi natupad ni FPJ, siya na ang tutupad sa 2016.
Well, ganun nga yung tanongan ngayon kasi nag-number one siya. Pero kung now we have the benefit of hindsight. Prior to that, people would start saying, remember she had that ad na Tatak FPJ and everyone were saying, ano naman yung Tatak FPJ? It hasn't been proven, di ba? Alam na ordinaryong tao, alam na malapit sa ordinaryong tao.
You mean they were thumbing their nose at Tatak FPJ?
What?
They were thumbing their nose
yes,
at you know?
Yes, di ba? So people were saying, what was that? With hindsight, now, itutuloy mo ang sinimulan, Tatak FPJ. Those are very vague messages.
Yeah.
What resonated only was FPJ.
But one thing, I think Malou also pointed out in her in a post that she I saw in Facebook is that the one thing attractive where she really exuded is humility. I mean, and the simplicity, you know, very clear. Of what she stood for as a candidate, the identification with FPJ. I mean, and I would like to think that humility is actually a real trait and not just a put on, right? Mm-hmm. And it seems like it's a real trait. In which case, I don't think 2016 running for 2016 will be on her sights. Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe for vice president should be asked, you know, just because she's number one.
Because she's coming across as somebody who doesn't crave for power or crave for a higher position.
I mean, Tony, she hasn't been on media. I mean, she gave one interview
siya kasi taga-monitor ng media dahil MTRCB siya.
She gave one interview na, this is for my dad. That's it.
Yeah.
I mean, a conventional political player would probably come up with some spin already. And she's number one and she's holding.
But look at it this way. When we saw the 2010 elections and we never expected a mayor from Makati was going to sweep the vice presidential race. I mean, he didn't really come out that much, than just the same, right? Pero, I mean, what would be the difference, say, with a Jejomar Binay ascending to the number two spot and the number one senator now, if it's official, for 2013, possibly gunning for the top spot in 2016?
Well, possibilities, yes. Oh, yeah. Di ba? But...
And they win ability.
Well, yes, right now. But... she really wanting to go for it, I doubt, you still feel
she'll be a reluctant candidate in 2016?
Not only that, I think compared to Vice President Binay understands the Filipino culture. As a result of it, you'll notice that he's a guy who has a big appeal on the masa. And if you compare...
So does Grace Poe.
But the point is, what makes her attractive is that she's humble. And if she actually runs for 2016, that that advantage will disappear because people will not see mm-hmm. someone gunning this early, gunning for a top
thinking
spot as a
it, yeah.
as an act of humility, honestly.
But if she really does well, if she performs well in the Senate, I think, do you think that there could be some groundswell of support for her in 2016?
Well, again, that's 3 years. Yeah. I don't think you can even pass a
bill.
Good legislation in 3 years. By December 2014, people are already talking about the pairing. I mean, once the proclamation is made by COMELEC,
sure.
then it's all going to be discussions for 2016. Mm. The only thing that the Grace Po number one position right now offers is that it disturbs
the vice president,
the pairing, and now there's yes. this wild card being thrown there, mm-hmm. who is popular, mm. who has the brand, but she still doesn't have the public record. Mm. But again, going back to what Tony said, yung humility, simplicity. I mean, if you again put Nancy Binay and Grace Po, I mean, they're very simple and very
sure.
mm-hmm. Humble. Mm-hmm. You don't see them with the trappings of power.
Mm-hmm.
You put there Sunny Angara, who had to do the tone down his being stiff and being very formal by just changing the costume.
Yeah.
And that elicited a lot of kilig from my group because nobody thought that Angara can be sexy,
okay.
right? So yung mga ganon, parang...
Let me not add to that, okay?
Okay.
But of course, the pairings, as you said, inevitably, people will now be looking at who's going to be the better ticket for 2016. But everybody, even before this midterm election, was already looking at the vice president, having announced it way ahead of everybody that he's gunning for the presidency in 2016. Now here comes Grace Po, a number one spot in the senatorial race. Is it likely that, anyway, since they're all rooted in the same political base, that a Binay-Po combination would be likely instead of Grace Po running for the presidency herself?
I think it's more likely that it's a Binay Estrada.
Still.
Jinggoy Estrada.
Yung pare, yung original
I think Po disturbs the other possible combinations. Mm-hmm. Because the other possible combination people have speculated on was going to be Rojas and Escudero, for example. Example, I mean, and now suddenly you have Po, and maybe that could be a possible combination, certainly.
But you know, because Grace Po ran with the administration ticket, is it likely that these alliances will still hold 3 years from now, that she'll still be with the administration or identified with the administration, if in case na akitin man siya nung kabila na dito ka na lang sa amin tumakbo for a higher position?
I think she will stay with the administration yeah. because when there was a time for her to make that decision, vis your ninong and the campaign manager of your father, you decided to join someone who talagang yeah. hindi mo naman talaga
no personal ties.
Yeah, yeah. right.
May
and
character.
Then and then the other side, all your friends are there. She was and the mother was part of the opposition. So I don't think she will abandon for the next 3 years. I think she will be with that coalition. What is interesting is that people would probably always have an open door for a Grace Po in any combination. Tony was talking about Mar. Here, it would appear that Team Pinoy, not LP, they will have to decide. With the coalition partners be with us? Or do we guys go our separate ways and nationalista, they have their very competitive candidates there in the person of Bongbong Marcos and Alan Peter Cayetano. You have the NPC also very, very powerful at the local level. So yung LP, that is one big problem that they will have to address. You have the core, the original LPs, who would probably want someone from their ranks.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then there is this talk about, you know, another Cheese Escudero thing. I don't know if it will launch this time.
Yeah.
So mga apat, madaming kombinasyon. Ang kagandahan si Grace is like Ilongga, a scared individual.